Adventures with Books has been paid for in part by the Sholo Library Friends. If you'd like to become a member of the Sholo Library Friends, please call 532-4070.
Hi, I'm here at Safeway, and on today's program, we're going to have fun with fruits, veggies, and the bakery. So welcome. Supermarket. I just love to go shopping for food and then go home and cook something. So I like that whole experience. I brought a book today. This is a great book. It's called Never Let Your Cat Make Lunch for You. It's very silly. It's by Lee Harris. Never let your cat make lunch for you. It's okay to let your cat make breakfast. My cat Pebbles makes me breakfast all the time. Oh, bacon and eggs. She likes to make fried eggs and bacon the best. Oh, that's nice. She made a smiley face. Sometimes there's cat hair in my eggs. It's true. If you live with a cat, you get cat hair everywhere. If I'm late for breakfast, she'll eat all the bacon. What she really makes well is oatmeal. Pebbles loves putting milk in things. It's true. Cats like milk too. Sometimes she puts too much milk in my oatmeal. Oh, is she slurping it up off the counter? Cats are good for that too. On cold mornings, Pebbles bakes muffins. Well, that's nice. The oven makes the whole kitchen warm. It's a great place for a cat nap. But never, ever let your cat make lunch for you. Look, she's very excited. One time, Pebbles made a peanut butter and jelly sandwich for me to take to school. She had to use her paws to spread the peanut butter and jelly because she can't hold a knife. Probably lots more cat hair, I'm guessing. All day, I was so hungry thinking about that sandwich. When lunch finally came, I hurried to the lunchroom and I took a gigantic bite out of my sandwich. I like peanut butter and jelly too. Oh, my friends knew something was wrong because I started making funny faces. When I lifted the bread, what did I find? Oh no. An anchovy right in the middle of my sandwich. It's a little tiny fish, like a sardine. Oh, that does not go with peanut butter and jelly. Only a cat would think an anchovy tastes good with peanut butter and jelly. Pebbles thinks anchovies taste good with everything. Yuck! There's an anchovy on an ice cream cone, on a cupcake, and in a glass of water. Imagine my surprise when I found out that nobody wanted to trade sandwiches with me. I don't think I'd trade for that either. They still remembered the mouse sandwich that I had from the day before. Oh no. Yuck. That's why I say never, and I mean never, ever let your cat make lunch for you. And that's the end of our tale. So that's a very silly book. And now I'm going to show you how to make your very own fancy pretzels.
Let's get started on our pretzel treats. This is a really easy and quick craft. You can do it for different times of year. I brought some pink sprinkles for Valentine's Day, but you could do Christmas, 4th of July, Halloween, anything you like. It's really easy. Just need a few things. You need a spoon to stir the melted chips. You need a couple of knives to help spread things on there. Butter knives are great. They're not sharp, so that's nice. I just brought a pair of scissors to cut open things. You need a bowl for each color of chips that you're going to use. You need a tray or little plate, something that you can catch the extra sprinkles in as you sprinkle them on. You need some kind of sprinkles. This one has little chunky hearts and red and pink. This one's for Valentine's Day. This one just has multicolored little sprinkles. So there's all kinds of sprinkles out there these days. So you can just really use your imagination for that. You need some sort of pretzel. I got the big pretzel sticks. If you don't want to do that, you'd rather use the little pretzels or the medium-sized ones, you can just dip the side in that. So also, you can use your imagination with that. You need some kind of chips to melt. I got candy melts from the store. You just microwave these. If you don't have any of that around, if you have like a 1 pound Hershey bar laying around, you can just melt that in the microwave too. The tricky part with these is you don't want to put it in there for 5 minutes and hope for the best. You want to microwave it for a little bit, and it actually explains that on the back. You microwave it for just a little bit and kind of stir it a little bit, you know, because you don't want it too cooked and overdone. And with this particular kind of Wilton, you can remelt them too. So if you don't use it all today, you can just, you know, cover it up and save it and remelt it another time. So let's get started. I'm going to cut the corner off of this. And with these, this is super easy. You just pour the melts in the dish. That looks good. Save some for next time. Actually, I'll add a few more. And I got white. You could use paste food coloring if you wanted a different color. They also have different colors at the store. They had pink and orange and black and just all different colors. I will say that a lot of candies, like food coloring and paste coloring and stuff, if you add enough stuff to make it really dark black, sometimes it does not taste super good. So you just pour these in a bowl. I'm going to run off and microwave them, and I'll meet you back here. All right, we're back. I microwaved the chips. They're nice and creamy now, kind of swirly. If it takes a long time and, you know, it kind of gets too thick, you could just run back and pop it in the microwave for about 15 or 20 seconds. That'll come right back. So we're going to get started. I got pretzel sticks out. Like I said, if you wanted to do the traditional twirly pretzels, you could just like dip half of it in there. There's all different ways that you can do this. So hold the stick over the bowl. We're just going to spread frosting on there, the melted candy. Do it about a third of the way down. Make sure you get that all nice and covered. Okay, just let the knife kind of rest there. And let's start off with, let's do a red one. Okay, now I'm gonna sprinkle these over this little tray. I brought it, like I said, you can use a plate from home or a tray. It's just like if you're doing glitter with another project, all the extra kind of squirts off at the bottom, and then you don't have the little bits of candy glitter all over the place. There we go. You could do more than one kind of thing. If you do, I'm doing the sprinkles on this pretty thick. If you're going to add more than one kind, then you want to, you know, leave some bare for the rest of it. So we've got a nice red and white one there. Actually, this is a little creamer mug. You need something to kind of set them up in so they can dry. There we go. Make sure it's something fairly heavy and sturdy, or after you get a few in there, it'll tip over and cause trouble, so you don't want that. So let's do another one. Let's do a blue one. All right. Same thing, just kind of start coating off. That's kind of a cool, funky color. You could just leave them plain too. I mean, like I said, there's a whole lot of different ways you could do this. There isn't any right or wrong way. And I also put paper towels down underneath the whole thing because you don't want to dribble chocolate or candy all over your kitchen table. You can use newspapers or whatever you have about. Let's see, let's do this one with sprinkles, multicolored sprinkles. Ooh, this one's got a lot. It's got a great big shaker. Okay, here we go. Woohoo! Oh, that's very festive looking. All right. Those are bouncing really well on this tray. All right. So there's that. Gets tricky also after you do a few to get them in there without getting a little bit of frosting on your hands. Okay. Let's do another white one. So like I said, you could do chocolate with orange and black for Halloween. Like I said, white and pink for Valentine's Day. It just boils down to how much time you want to spend working on it, but this is a really easy project. After they dry, you can kind of wrap them in like cellophane real loosely so they don't get mushed. And you can give these as presents too. People always like to get candy. I know I do. All right. Let's do hearts on this one. So this one's gonna be really chunky. And you can have your a grown-up or an older brother or sister help you melt the chocolate in the microwave, but this is a pretty easy craft to do even with little kids because there really isn't anything dangerous except for melting the chocolate. Make sure when you get the bowl out of the microwave that you use a hot pad because it is going to be really hot on the bottom. Another one. Let's see, two more. Looks like this turquoise color is really pretty thin. You could put silver balls on this and it would kind of look like turquoise jewelry. Could do that. Like I said, your imagination can just run wild with these. It's really kind of fun. And you can never go wrong with just plain old milk chocolate. Let's do pink. It's always fun to do something different. Do pink on one side. How about pink Jimmy sprinkles on the other side? Those little long sprinkles. Let's do that. You could also roll these in chopped nuts if you want to, or coconut. I just like sprinkles myself, so I thought that'd be fun. So that one's kind of cool. It's kind of a two-sided. And one left. And see, this is starting to get a little bit thick, but like I said, if it gets too thick to spread and it doesn't want to go on there, you just pop it back in the microwave for just 15 seconds and you're right back where you started. Let's do a white one with sprinkles. That one always shows off rainbow colors really well. Woo! Boy, those really come out of there. I'll be sharing these with the entire studio. That one looks really cool, like a rainbow. So here's our finished product. If you can, kind of separate them a little so there's a little bit of room in between them so they don't stick together. Don't forget to put the lid back on the sprinkles, because if you knock it over, that's a lot of trouble. And I have one more cool thing to show you. I brought this little tiny box. You can throw the sprinkles away if you want to. I got this little tiny box at the dollar store. You can kind of make your own little everything kind of sprinkle stuff. You just pour it in this box, and then the next time you go, this will have rainbow sprinkles and pink sprinkles. You don't want to put this in there because it had that frosting, the candy melt stuck to that. So just pour that in there. You're on your way to a whole box of everything sprinkles. I really like that too. So this is just a fun and really easy craft that you can even do at a birthday party too. That's fun too. And now let's go to the grocery store. We're here in the Safeway produce section, and today we're going to talk with Brian. Hi, thanks for taking the time to visit with us today.
Pleasure to meet you too. Hi, guys.
So we're just looking around at all the really cool vegetables and fruit and produce that you have here. So where does all this come from?
Different areas, mainly this time of year. A lot of the apples are still from the United States. Sometimes out of season, we'll source Chile as well as New Zealand for a certain kind of apples.
So the country of Chile.
Yes,
wow, that's a long way. Okay.
Absolutely.
So what were the New Zealand apples over here?
Well, we haven't received the New Zealand ones yet. Some of the Chilean products aren't so much the apples. They're still from the United States. When we tour the department, we can look at some products from Chile. The grapes, for example.
Okay.
The grapes, for example, are from Chile. Let's go over here.
Okay. Oh, I can tell you guys are putting stuff out right now.
Right, all the time. Very, very busy, yeah. So in summertime, late summer, they're from the United States right now. They're from Chile. It's just so we can supply that product year-round, and that's the main concern at a retail level, so.
Okay.
Over here, we have an heirloom tomato that's a real popular item, as well as a new product. It's a Siena tomato on the vine. It's a similar product to this, but.
But those are ripe, even though
absolutely.
They're that color.
All product should be ready to eat. Now, some of the fruit, we're a large volume store. You do have to let it ripen slightly.
I love these heirloom tomatoes.
Perfect.
Because they're all kinds of funky colors, and they're all really yummy.
This is a dragon fruit.
Huh.
It's a real interesting piece. I want you to get this real close.
I have never tried one of those.
Right, due to research and checking things out. Tastes a lot like a kiwi and a pear is what I've been taught and learned myself. Also, coconuts carrying different items, trying to create, in produce, variety is everything. So we do a lot with variety, trying to expand always the selection of products we carry. Something else, we have melons here that chilled, ready to wash and cut for any need that you would have.
Nice cantaloupe. Ooh,
this time
little...
of year, they're Chilean, Guatemalan. I mean, I'm sorry, they're from Guatemala. We also have some melons from Honduras. It's just, like I said, only so we can supply that product
right.
all year round. So
right.
Something we're doing. We have a premium juice set. Juices are really, really big these days.
They are.
Kombucha is an item that's pretty popular. And
so where do you keep all the produce when it's not out here?
Come back here and let me show you.
Okay.
This is a cut room, and it's clean. If you do go in there, you have to wear a hairnet. Easy stuff like that. This is basically the dry section of the produce back room where we can keep all our dry product ready
for onions,
potatoes, tomatoes,
right?
All things like that. Keep some of our organics over there on the side. Some of the equipment we use as well. And then inside there is where we keep all the refrigerated produce. Come on in, guys.
Oh, burr.
Well, the produce cooler runs between 34 and 40 degrees, depending on how long the door is open. It's very important it's not under 34 degrees, because we don't want to freeze the produce.
Right, because then that's problems.
Absolutely. We just have different sections that where we keep it. I know, guys, I'm sorry, we're just real, real busy. These are different areas where we keep our product on backstock and
right.
you know, work all day at it. And it's just due to the large variety, we have tons and tons of
right.
being a large volume
right.
store, tons of stuff.
So I have one question. What is your favorite fruit to eat?
I'm a citrus fan, 100%. Navel orange and the clementines, like
mm-hmm.
I showed you out on the floor
I like
earlier.
Those too, yeah.
Real big fan. Newer products are the Tangelo.
Mm-hmm.
Manola is a really good product, as well as the Caracara orange, which is a real similar to a regular orange, except for it's a little pink inside.
Oh.
It's got just a little slightly tartar
cool.
taste.
Cool. Okay.
I'm a citrus guy, but everyone has their favorites.
Cool. Well, thanks very much for taking time to talk with us.
Pleasure.
I really appreciate it.
Thank you for coming down.
Thanks, and this is just really, really fascinating to me.
It's an honor for you guys to come down.
Okay.
You guys have a great day.
Thanks, yes. you too. I just wanted to point out one more thing before we leave the produce department. If you think cauliflower is kind of bland and weird, check these out. They now have orange, purple, and light green cauliflower.
Now, I will say if you steam them, the color disappears, but they still taste really yummy like cauliflower. And if you eat them raw in a salad, they look really cool. Hi, I'm talking here today with Diana. Thanks again for taking time to visit with us.
Not a problem.
It's so interesting. And we're in front of one of my favorite sections right here. This has all of the fun and yummy muffins and pastries.
Strudels, yeah. This is our French bread.
Oh, and sourdough.
This is our signature French bread. This is our, very proud of this product.
And you make that yourself
we
here?
We do. We make it here.
Can we go see that?
Absolutely.
Okay.
There's a 50-pound bag of flour in there right now.
Wow.
And we're putting the salt and the base and the yeast in there. And now I need to, we have this water meter. We have to first cool the water.
So that makes it the perfect temperature?
Yeah, it has a temperature on there, yeah. So you'll see right now it's 64 degrees.
Right.
We want to get it down to 40 or so, maybe even lower. It helps to keep the dough cool enough when you're working with it. It doesn't get too hot and start to grow on you. So you want to start.
The yeast part of
mm-hmm.
it, okay.
Yes.
So you have to cool the water down.
Yes.
That's interesting.
Yes, if it was warm, you would have to run.
So you guys weigh what you put in there?
Yes.
You don't use measuring cups, you just do it by weight?
When you bake, it is by formula. It's a perfect science, basically. When you're a cook, you just, bam, like Emerald,
right.
Just do whatever you feel and taste and adjust. This has to be the same every time.
So it's exactly the same, okay.
See, now we're down to 34 degrees, 35. I'm gonna stop this and then put our, and this will automatically give us exactly how much water we need.
Really, because that was my next question, how do you know how much?
See, there's 30 pounds right there.
Uh-huh.
And then I just press start, it's gonna stop when it's done.
Huh.
Pretty awesome, huh?
That's pretty awesome. Wow, look at that. It's bread dough now.
Yeah.
That's pretty easy.
So, like I said before, everything is precise, so I have to weigh this. And I am wearing my cutting glove, I'm being safe. It's all about safety. So we gotta get 30 pounds on here.
30 pounds?
30 pounds.
Holy cow.
And I just have to make my scale level there. Okay. Thank you. Okay.
So you just stick that whole blob in there?
You stick the whole blob in, a blob comes in and pieces come out. Dun, 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 dun.
Wow.
See?
So each one of those is gonna make a loaf of bread.
Each one of these is gonna be a loaf of French bread.
That is really fascinating.
There you go.
So this turns into that.
That turns into that.
Wow. That is so cool.
What we do is we make the dough the day ahead, so this dough is for tomorrow. We put it in the refrigerator, and in the morning, the first baker in the day pulls it out, puts it to raise in the proofer. I can show you the proofer, and I'll show you the oven, too. And then they bake everything. We make it today, and they bake it tomorrow. This is our proofer, and when you have yeast in your dough, you need to put it in the proofer to raise. So, look how big it is. It holds about 10 racks.
And how long does it have to rise?
It takes about 45 minutes or so.
Oh, okay.
You have to check it. Some things go faster,
right,
some things
right.
go slower. So you have to keep an eye on everything. And it's not hot in here. It's about 100 degrees, so you can touch things in here.
Right.
It's not too hot. But when we get to the oven, you have to use a lot of care.
Right.
This oven holds 2 racks.
Wow.
See how big that is?
That is hot.
So you slide 2 racks on there and you can bake four racks at a time. We have two ovens.
That's really cool.
We call them tiers, but two different times at different temperatures.
Huh. So you can do donuts and bread.
Well, if our bread, with this French bread, it goes in for 10 minutes on one temperature and another 10 minutes on another temperature.
Oh, okay.
Yes, and it has so an smart automatic steam. This is steam right here. So the steam gives it a nice shine.
Oh, that
is
beautiful.
So there's your insider information.
Cool. Okay. Hey, I need a loaf of bread for dinner tonight. Could you slice a loaf of that up for me, please?
This is our fresh French bread right here. I'll slice one up for you.
I love your French bread.
Okay, remember me talking before about safety.
Right?
These are very, very sharp.
Yes, that looks very sharp.
Yes. This is a cutting, it's a pusher, actually. So you don't put your hand back there.
I bet you that takes a lot of practice to get that out perfectly, doesn't it?
I've been with this company 25 years, so I have had lots of practice.
Because I bet if I did that, it would not come out like that. So.
Okay, and then I just put it in our paper bag. And there you go. There's your fresh French bread.
Cool. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
And thanks for visiting with us today.
Thank you.
It was so interesting.
I'm glad.
Okay.
I'll see you back at the library.
That was so cool at the supermarket, and I'm so glad that I got to try one of those dragon fruits. It was really kind of cool and funky. I hope you had fun today. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
Adventures with Books has been paid for in part by the Sholo Library Friends. If you'd like to become a member of the Sholo Library Friends, please call 532-4070.